Davis, and I would like to ask you if we could have a little bit of the background of Homeboy Industries.
Sure. Homeboy Industries was started in 1988. Father Greg Boyle was a young Jesuit who had been volunteering and working in South America. And when he returned to the United States in Los Angeles, he asked to be placed in the poorest parish in LA. That parish was in Boyle Heights, Dolores Mission. And when he arrived, it was in the midst of some of the worst gang battles in history. It was actually the worst time, I believe, at that time in Boyle Heights, there were 11 warring gangs within that one neighborhood. And the mortality rate was very high. People were dying, and he was burying mothers' children, and the mothers themselves came to Father Greg to ask for a way to help for it to stop. So he thought about it, and he spoke with some of the young men and said, what would you need for in order to stop living this way? And the three things that came out were education, tattoo removal, and job training. So that was the premise of his starting what they call Jobs for a Future. They started with a high school at the Dolores Mission Parish. I believe he asked the nuns to move out, and they did, and they started school there. And tattoo removal, we had a lot of help from White Memorial in Boyle Heights, and they started the first tattoo removal program. And then job training came in the form of our first social enterprise, which was a bakery, because there's a bakery across the street that was vacant. And Father Greg spoke with some of the people who were supporting him, and we were able to start our first social enterprise and get people to bake bread together. And Father Greg says we don't hire homies to bake bread, we bake bread to hire homies. So it's the opportunity to transform and change your life that comes with the work we do, even though we believe that our program is about healing. From the very beginning, there's also work. So as you're working on your insides, you're also doing whatever physical work there is, because the object is to go through your training program here to utilize all the wraparound services like therapy, tattoo removal, classes, education, job training, so that when you're finished with your time here, anger management, did I say that? When you're finished with your time here, that you can go out and actually be a contributing member of the community. And 28 years later, that is definitely the case. We were the first off-ramp for men and women who were stuck in multi-generational lives of gang activity, poverty, and incarceration. And now people know where they can come when they're ready to stop.
Mission of joining a gang.
Honestly, I was never really joined a gang, But I grew up around all violence, seeing all kinds of crazy stuff when I was coming up as a youngster. The reason I never joined the gang is because when I was 14, before my dad passed away, he told me to promise him that I would never join the hood. So to me, to join the hood now, that's just disrespect for my dad, you get me?
Yeah.
Like for me to get in the neighborhood. Don't get me wrong, I have those days where I do want to join the hood, where I'm dealing with shit, Other people trying to fuck with me because they think I'm from the neighborhood that I grew up in. But because of my dad, I promised him I wasn't gonna join the neighborhood, so I never did.
But was it because of the urban community you lived in?
Because of the people I surrounded myself. There would be days I knew what I was coming out seven to, Everybody does. I knew if I go down the block, I knew I was probably gonna get shot or I was gonna have to run the cops, Just because I was trying to slang. But honestly, I don't know, it's crazy, You just gotta live it to know it, I guess. You know what I mean?
What led you to to be in this organization?
To me, this program?
Yeah.
Honestly, it took a lot for me to come to this program, I remember when I had, when that guy got locked up for like my fifth time I was incarcerated, my PO wanted me to come to this program, and then I came, and I lied to her. I told her I went, I talked to the people, I told them I was gonna get into the program, but I never did. I left, and they told me to come back. I never came back, because I was being a knucklehead. I was out there running the street with my boys, And after, honestly, I've been busted a lot of times, And this is the last time. I've already been out for like a year and like 5 months, I say. No, it's the last time I've ever been locked up. And that's when I came to this program, you know. My PO came to me. She drove me here. We're eating down there in the cafe. Told me, go in the office to go talk to the people. And I met one of the homies right here. You know, one of my dad's older homies. And he talked to me. He told me, hey, homie, start the program, you know. Get to know the people here, you know. Get involved. And little by little I did, you know. Little by little started coming out. Like, I talked to everybody, you know. Now I feel like I fit in, you know. Like, all this good is coming to me now. Sometimes I sit there and I'm like, oh, like, I don't even deserve it, you know, because of all the wrong I did. But little do I know, I guess, I mean, you know.
So how has it helped you?
It helped me. I'm about to graduate high school already. I'm just 16, finally. And I don't know how the hell, but I finished my math classes just like 2 weeks ago. I don't know how I finished all that. I can't even remember doing any other math, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's so crazy, but this program helped me, like, I guess just get to know myself better, you know?
Yeah.
Get to know what I really want, you know? Like, I learned how to control my anger now. Before, I would have a short fuse, I'd get mad fast, you know? Now I could just, like, you know, I bump into a situation, and I'd be able to cool myself down, you know? Like, I know how to work on myself, you know, think twice about what I'm doing, you know, more wise about my decisions.
Yeah. Before you begin coming to this program, did you like going to school?
Nah, I didn't like school. Okay. And I still don't. Well, not a lot of people like school, but I mean, I'm about to start college, you know? Well, yeah, I'm going to start college.
So what makes
college,
you?
And I guess from being in college, that's going to open my mind to more things, more options. Mm-hmm. People are telling me, you're going to like college more than you like high school. So first, I didn't want to go to college, but now it's something I want to do, you know?
What makes you go to school?
Makes me go to school? Just knowing I'm going to get my diploma pretty soon. I don't know how, like I say, I don't know how I got this far, but no, I'm thankful. You know, I'm gonna graduate. Sometimes I doubt myself. You know, there's still today, like, I'm like, oh, like, it's too much work, you know?
Yeah.
But I try to go home and do it. Or sometimes I'm here, you know, I'm doing it. It's hard, but, you know, I get help and I get some tutors here, you know? It's all right. I get through it. Somehow I finish my work. It's crazy.
Okay, the first one is, what made you take the decision of joining again?
They're my, like, family. They help me with everything. They're not all bad. They're not negative. They help me with everything. Like, when my family wasn't there, like, they'll help me pay this. But you could be in a gang, and it could be positive or negative. It's whatever decision you want to make, you know? So.
Okay. Was it because you lived in an urban community that made you take the decision?
No. I don't think it does have to do with your community, but it's more about how the household is too. Well, the community does have something to do with it, because I grew up in Long Hill, so it does a little bit, you know? Your friends, whoever you hang out with is who you turn out to be. Like, you know how you heard the same feathers of the bird flock today? Well, my friends were all guys and stuff, and then I ended up being just like them. I wanted to do everything they did, you know? So it does.
Okay. Was it difficult for you to find a job, even though you had tattoos?
Yes, because I have a record. Like, I would put makeup on. I put makeup on, and then it was still hard. I tried to go to Chipotle. They didn't want to hire me because I have 2 felonies for firearms, so they didn't want to hire me nowhere. And I put makeup on, but I couldn't, you know?
How long did it take you to find a job?
Usually I come here. It's my fifth time coming to this program.
Mm-hmm.
Usually I get incarcerated, and I've been working since I was 16, but I keep coming back, you know? But this time I'm really doing good. Like, I would really tell them too if I was doing bad, you know? This time I'm really doing good though, and how long it took me to find a job?
Yeah.
This time I got out, I tried to get a job by myself, because I didn't want to come here no more. I wanted a full-time job, like, right away.
Yeah.
And I couldn't find one. I had interviews too at Chipotle, and I couldn't find them. They didn't take me. Nah.
Okay, what led you into seeking for a second chance and being in this program?
What made me want to be in this program?
Yeah.
Because they always welcome us. They, you know, no matter what, like, I got fired last time for, you know, but they always welcome us back. Like, Father G, you know, he told me to start working the next day, you know, because I had to pay rent. and I'm gonna have a kid, you know, in 2 months. So, you know, he took me back.
The obstacles while you were seeking for a change?
Well, the obstacles for me was being that I was in prison for 25 years. I served 25 years. I was a former lifer inmate. Those were my obstacles there. You know, being serving prison time and finding my freedom one day. And never thought I was ever going to get my freedom. And then today, actually, I'm celebrating my fourth year out. I got out 4 years ago. And here I am, you know, after 4 years. And I learned about homeboys while I was incarcerated. I learned about homeboys 25 years ago. I learned about Father Greg Boyle. And learning about Father Greg Boyle, I was fascinated by him. And then I found out there was an organization called Homeboy Industries that Father Greg had something to do with it. And from that moment on, I planted a positive seed in my heart and said, you know what? I would love to become part of this organization. Maybe one day I'll get out. Who knows? You know, being that I was a lifer inmate, I never was going to see the streets. So I never gave up. You know, I kept my head up high, and I kept on moving ahead. I kept visualizing my freedom, and finally it happened. You know, I on my seventh parole hearing, on a day after Thanksgiving of 2011, I was found suitable for parole, and then I had to wait 5 long months to get my final review by Governor Brown to see if they were going to give me my freedom. And and then May 3rd of 2012 came around, and once that had happened, everything came out fine. I came home after serving 25 years and stuff, and then I came here. As soon as I walked in here, it was a week after I had gotten out from prison that I walked into Homeboys, because, you know, I already had planted that seed in my heart, and I wanted to become part of the organization. When I got out, my family wanted to say, oh, but we already got a job for you, because, you know, a lot of my family have money. A lot of my family come from a background of law enforcement. That was my dream. I was going to become law enforcement or a childhood development counselor before I got myself in trouble. So my parents said, oh, we got a job for you. I go, no, I'm not gonna be privileged. I don't want to work. He goes, well, what do you want to do? How are you going to get a job? Well, I committed a crime. Now I want to learn how to do it in my own way. I want to find my own job. Well, where are you going to go? She goes, I want to go to Homeboy Industries. I'm going, well, that's only for gang members. I go, Mom, I used to be a gang member. He goes, well, they got cons that go there. I go, well, Mom, I was in prison for 25 years with the biggest cons in the world. Oh, okay, my mom was still treating me like if I was 18 years old, you know? And so I came here. I got to meet my idol, Father Greg Boyle. And a week after I got out, I became part of the 18-month program. In that 18-month program, I learned how to fight more of my fears. Now that I was out here in the free world, I needed the life skills. How am I going to transition myself out here? So Homeboys gave me those tools, and I started to work on them. I started to remove all my tattoos. When I got out, I had my neck was fully collaged with tattoos. As you can see, you can't really tell my tattoos. I had 25 sessions done my neck. Very painful. It's like a hot rubber band popping my skin. I have still removing all my tattoos out of my hands. And so, you know, it's a process. And removing these, you know, I allowed boredom to get the best of me when I was incarcerated, because I thought I was never going to get out at one point. So I put all this ink work on me, and I felt it was the right thing to do. And being that I was caught up in gang lifestyle, and now that I'm out, you know, I wanted to be a role model. I wanted to set that good example to a lot of these young men and women that lifestyle isn't really nothing. It's this lifestyle that you're going to just lose out in life, because everybody you go against out here in the streets, basically of your own, you become your worst enemy, becomes your best friend. And that's something that I learned here while I was incarcerated. And then coming out here in the streets and seeing everybody here getting along with one another. And now that I'm out here, I learned to do so much stuff. Like, I work with like juvenile detentions, orphanages. I did presentations.
I grew up in San Fernando Valley. Started gangbanging when I was 16.
valley. I got married. I went to the condo. Got married when I was like 21. I had my second child at 24. I was 4 months pregnant. The father of my child was gunned down in the street. He passed away and died. So after that, I really didn't have anything. I didn't really care about anything. I didn't know how to breathe, so I took my pain and started gangbanging and selling drugs and going out of the state and taking drugs. I ended up getting caught, I got arrested, and the first time I got arrested, they gave me 10 years, so my sentence was for 10 years. Out of those 10 years, I did 5 years, and I got out, I didn't know where to start. I started looking for jobs, and I couldn't get it due to my circumstances. I walked into Homeboy Industries, and this was a unique place which opened the doors for me and helped me realize who I was and that I just didn't know how to breathe and I didn't know what to do with the pain, like I said, so they helped me how to figure that out and figure out who I was. Homeboy Industries has taught me how to use the tools that they provide for me. They have therapy here, I do substance abuse, I do parenting, they are helping me with my children to get them back because I've got them taken away. I've been working here for 7 months. I am supervisor for community service here. I am enrolled in college, it's my second semester in college, and I am going for communications, trying to get my associate's in communications, and after that, my bachelor's, and soon I'm going to start getting on both classes to be a youth counselor.
Se diga del diga, William Landrón y yo somos socios de la avenida. Soy bandolero como el mister politiquero, que se robó todo el dinero y lo postularon de nuevo. Como si fuera caldeo dos bombas, nos daban conspiración, la llave.